KICI-LP 105.3 FM is Iowa City's nonprofit local radio station. We rely on listener support, and you can help us continue to air great programming like Democracy Now!, Great Taste, Green Room IC, The Situation Room, and This Way Out by making a one-time donation or setting up a recurring donation at our website, KICIRadio.org. Just click on the donate button and become part of the team. KICI-LP. Low power, high impact.
Coming up on the Green Room IC, the Iowa City Community Theater makes a return visit to discuss the final show of their 2022-2023 season, Stephen Sondheim's Follies. Joining Beverly Mead are Taylor Gomez, Marcia Hughes, Angela McConville, and Josh Sazon. The interview was recorded using Zoom video service on April 11th, 2023.
It's a show that isn't done terribly often, Steve Sondheim's show, and it's one that's been very dear to my heart. Goodness knows why. It's an absolutely depressing
show. Well, the showgirls are sort of like ethereal, ghostly entities that move across the stage and kind of represent the glory days of the theater.
The show takes place in a rundown theater, so anyone who's familiar with ICCT knows that it doesn't necessarily take much to make it look that way.
Hello, listeners. Welcome back to the Green Room IC. Today, I have the pleasure of talking with Josh Sazon, director of Iowa City Community Theater's upcoming production of Follies, as well as cast members Marcia Hughes as Phyllis, Angela McConville as Carlotta, and Taylor Gomez as Showgirl. Welcome. It is great to have you all here.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bev.
Yeah. Our audience members always like to know who's behind the mic. So could you please each tell our listeners a little bit about yourselves, such as your background in theater, where you come from, that type of thing? Let's see here. Josh, you don't like to talk too much about yourself, but could you at least tell somebody something?
Hi, my name is Josh Sazon. I am a longtime lurker. Basically, you know, hides in the shadows of the backstage. Mm-hmm. And I'm pleased to actually be working with these fine individuals. I should add, too, that Taylor Gomez is not just a showgirl. She is also the choreographer of this.
Yeah, and we'll talk about
wild extravaganza.
Thanks, Josh.
Okay, Taylor, go ahead.
Yes, as Josh mentioned, my name is Taylor Gomez, and I am the choreographer, and along with being a showgirl, I also play Margie, which is an exciting role for me because it's my first singing role as a lifelong dancer. So yeah, it's kind of a breakout for me.
Well, that's great. Okay, looking at my screen, let's go to Angela McConville next.
I'm Angela. I have been in this area since about 2000. But I started doing theater in 2015 and 2016, kind of as a thing to do as an adult to make friends. You might have seen me most recently in Elf as the office manager, Deb. Yeah, and I'm excited to be in Follies. I've been looking forward to this show since before the pandemic. And Carlotta is a dream role for me. So
excellent. Marcia, could you tell our listeners a little bit about yourself, such as your background in theater, where you come from, etc.?
Well, hi, I'm Marcia Hughes. This is the third show I've done with ICCT. I was previously an ICC at ICCT as MAME in MAME, and also in the Bessel Whorehouse in Texas. And also, I've done a lot of theater here in the Cedar Rapids area, at Theater Cedar Rapids, the Mirror Box, Giving Tree, and I've done some work with Riverside Theater and also Old Creamery Theater. And I do a lot of vocal work with several bands and groups that way. And as a profession, I've worked in education for a long, long time, where currently I'm the director of the Montessori School in Cedar Rapids.
Oh, very good. All right, thank you. Josh, what was it about this play that drew you to it and made you want to direct it?
Oh, gosh, it's a show that isn't done terribly often. It is a Steve Sondheim show, and it's one that's been very dear to my heart. Goodness knows why. It's an absolutely depressing show. But lots of good tunes in it. It offers some tap dancing. It offers me the chance to, I don't know, herd a bunch of cats. But it's a fairly large cast, and especially for a musical that does not have children, let me repeat, that does not have children, it is a nice challenge. It's also a show that allows for a wide variety of female performers, of which we have a lot in the area, to showcase their works. I mean, we have Margie, who's never sung before. We have Angie, who basically hits the ball out of the park with probably one of the best known tunes of the show. So it's a great hoot to.
Excellent, excellent. Well, could you give us a brief overview of the storyline for those who are not familiar with it?
Sure. The Follies is essentially a reunion of former Wiseman girls, Wiseman being sort of the impresario of the time. He basically produces these Follies, or these essentially variety acts that have been very popular in between the wars, between World War I and World War II. And this play takes place in 1970. Theater is about to be demolished, and he decides to, you know, throw this party for all the Follies girls who have traipsed the stage. And so they come in, they trade memories, and they do a little song and dance. Great hilarity is had.
Well, we have three of the actors here with us today. How many people are in the cast altogether?
I've lost count. I believe we were talking about 26 at one point.
Oh my goodness, that's fabulous. And that's no children.
No children.
I love that. Okay. It looks from the cast list as though you have several people involved who are new to Iowa City Community Theater. Having new people audition and get cast in shows is always a great thing to have happen. How is that working out for everyone? Josh?
Oh, I think it's better to ask the cast about that. Honestly, I have another biased view.
Yeah, okay. So ladies, what do you think? Is it working out well to have newbies with you?
I always love meeting new people that are involved and interested in theater. Both of the people on this call with me were new to me in a show at ICCT. Taylor now and Angie and I met in Bessel Whorehouse in Texas. So getting to build those relationships with someone who's new to work with is always great fun for me. I really enjoy it. And this time there are quite a few new people and yet quite a few people I know. So it's a lovely mix of making new friends and getting reacquainted with some folks that I haven't had the chance to spend much time with since before the pandemic. So that's an added benefit to the opportunity to have a fairly large group and some new people and some returning people.
Excellent. Taylor or Angie, you want to add anything to that?
Sure. Well, working as a choreographer in community theater, I often get the chance to work with a variety of exposures to dance. So I think it's an interesting challenge often to get to interact with people who've maybe never been on stage before and find a way to make them feel very confident dancing on stage for the first time.
Okay, very good. Angie?
I really think this show brings together people I've known for a long time, people who have done theater for a long time, but I've never met. I've just like fangirled them in shows. And then new people, or people who have done shows in other theaters I haven't seen at ICCT. So this is really a great thing for ICCT to start bringing in new people and show them how, you know, that theater runs, and hopefully they'll keep auditioning.
Very good. Okay, ladies, could you please each give our listeners an overview of your individual characters? Let's start with you, Taylor, because you're doing two of them.
Sure. Well, the showgirls are sort of like ethereal, ghostly entities that move across the stage and kind of represent the glory days of the theater and the showgirls that would occupy the stage back in the day. And so we do a lot of the same choreography as the reunion attendees. However, we have to be doing it like as if people are coming to see us and pay us for it. So it has to be a little bit sharper. And then as Margie, I am Buddy's other woman, and I am the one who loves him unconditionally, but his feelings for me aren't returned.
Oh, okay. Marcia, how about you? You play Phyllis, as I understand.
I do. I play Phyllis, and she's one of the two couples, the four individuals who had known each other and been friends when they were working at the theater 30 years prior. So the two couples, the two women and the two men, ended up marrying their respective boyfriends and girlfriends. And now we've returned to the theater, and there's, you know, a little bit of angst with recalling how things were in the past, for better or for worse, and having those ghosts roaming around that theater while we're there is fairly interesting, continuing to remind us of different things that happened in our past. Phyllis has may have gone a path that she wishes she had chosen differently. This was the path she chose, and once her choices were made, they were chiseled in marble, as is one of the lines. at that point, she made the very best of the situation that she's had. But of course, during this reunion, she's being presented with the possibility of something different happening in front of her, and she's acting on that in the course of the show. She's just a delicious character to play. I'm very excited to get the chance to do it.
Well, I can't wait to see it. Angie, you're Carlotta. Who is Carlotta?
So I get to play one of my favorite types of characters, basically. I'm a former showgirl. I'm kind of aloof. I'm a little bit full of myself.
No, we're asking about Carlotta.
Yeah. Oh, yes. They typecast.
Yes. Okay.
I am a former showgirl, but I then went on to do movies. Carlotta did. Okay. And now she is a TV star, and I'm there, and they are lucky to have my presence at this reunion.
I see. Very good. All right. Well, Marcia and Angie, you've been in several shows over the years, together and not together. Have you been in shows with Taylor?
No, this is my first experience working with Taylor, and she's been incredibly patient with the fact that that isn't my forte, especially when she added the app in front of the word dance. Then it became, I've done theaters for a lot of years, nearly all over 40 years. And no one has ever asked me to try to do a tap dance move in 40 years. So I've never even been asked. It's in presenting choreography and dance, it's never been a word that's ever been used in front of me before. So that's been interesting. And Taylor's a very patient person, so I've enjoyed that.
That's good. Angie, how about you?
This is my first time
with Taylor,
working with Taylor as well.
Well, this is great.
Yeah, I just got done doing a little tap. I was allowed to do a little bit of tap in Elf. So
Yes, Angie's a phenomenal clapper. We were not able to use her to her full ability, unfortunately.
Angie loves it. She kept asking more and more, and I kept trying to stick a sock in her mouth as that was going. More and more. Oh, no, Angie, back up. Please get behind us. She loves that.
We have a good example of two ends of the spectrum, then, when it comes to finding choreography that sort of meets right in the middle.
That's great. Well, Taylor, another question for you here. You're wearing three hats in this production. You are showgirl, you are Margie, and you are choreographer. Has there been any difficulty in balancing those three hats?
Oh, no.
Or have people worked well enough with you that you feel comfortable in any hat?
I don't really find any trouble in balancing the difference between cast member and like production staff or whatever. But I think it's almost easier because I don't have to teach somebody else to do it. I can just do it myself.
And then
there are also benefits to me being on stage and potentially being at the front, the downstage, where people behind me can see me, and it can help with tempo and remembering what comes next. So I haven't had any issues with it so far. I'm excited.
All right, very good. Josh, got to ask you a few questions here.
Mm-hmm.
Besides your choreographer, who designed your set and who is your musical director?
Music director is Wes Hadley. I've worked with for
wonderful,
a long time. Jim Mayfield is in charge of the set construction. We pretty much cobbled together the set. It's relatively impressive. I mean, the show takes place in a rundown theater, so anyone who's familiar with KICI-LP knows that it doesn't necessarily take much to make it look that way. However, I think we did some nice things with it. So
very good, very good. Do you know how many are in the orchestra? Just out of curiosity.
I believe it was about 26 the last time I checked with Wes.
Oh, wonderful! Nice big full sound.
Yes, and very tightly fit into that space.
Yes. Well, that's our wonderful Wes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I was able to interview him yesterday for the Silver Swing Band that he's in. So that was fun. Okay, because of the ongoing damdemic, and yes, I said that intentionally, theaters have encountered many difficulties. While things have eased up recently, Josh, what have you been doing to keep your cast and crew safe?
Well, I hate to say it, but the onus for keeping healthy really for cast members good at it. Those folks who feel a little bit under the weather are encouraged to not attend rehearsals, and some of them do, or if they do attend, they wear masks. So we try to keep as much of a protocol as we could in terms of keeping people healthy. And I won't say whether we've been lucky or not in keeping our cast healthy, but for the most part, we've been relatively intact.
That sounds great. During the performances, are masks going to be required for audience members?
No, they're not. I don't think KICI-LP is asking folks to wear masks. However, if they are more comfortable wearing masks while watching the show, I mean, we certainly won't forbid them to do that.
Very good. Very good. What are the run dates, including curtain times, for each performance?
It's 7:30 in the evening on a Friday and Saturday, and we have a Sunday matinee at 2 p.m. And this runs the last weekend of April and the first weekend of May. I believe the April dates are the 28th, 29th, and 30th, and the weekend after in May.
Right. Very good. Where is the show being performed?
Well, it's performed at the Johnson County Fairgrounds Exhibition Hall A, where most of the most of ICC productions are performed. So that hasn't changed very much.
Very good. Very good.
Originally, Follies was supposed to have been the last show in the old ICCT space. And in fact, we were talking about having a wrecking ball parked right outside the theater, and for the last performance, just, you know, let it swing. Unfortunately, that's not happening. So the fairgrounds pretty much decided, especially from what I've heard, they don't necessarily have enough funds to create a new building out of the old one in this old space. They decided to just leave the old building be and lease it out to ICCT for another year. That having been said, I believe the first and the last show of next season will be outside the fairgrounds. They'll be at Lower City Park at the Riverside stage.
That's correct. For those audience members who are like me, it is important to know, is ICCT handicap accessible?
ICCT is handicap accessible. It is flat. You don't have to go upstairs. We can accommodate wheelchairs. Just don't be terribly surprised if you have a showgirl fall on your lap. but other than that, we should be fine.
Okay. Now, how would you rate this show if you need to? I'm going to ask Angie to respond to this one as a member of the cast. How would you rate the show if you need to, with regard to how appropriate it would be for younger viewers, say 13 and under?
Well, you're probably asking the wrong person, because I've taken my daughter to every show, even somewhat questionable ones, and she's only 11. So I would say this is a show for everybody.
Okay.
But I think adult populations will be most interested and follow the story because it'll relate to them on an intimate personal level, the story between Sally and Phyllis. So, yeah.
Okay, well, that sounds good. And I, whoever wants to answer this one, if parents have concerns, you know, they're thinking, oh, my child can, maybe they shouldn't go, but who can I ask to find out a little more about this? Who can they contact?
Are we talking about the show itself? If they want to know
anything? The show itself, yes.
And, well, there is an ICCT website. If we're talking about children specifically, honestly, they might be somewhat amused by the dancing and the singing, but the subject matter itself, I don't think would be of much interest to kids. And if anyone in the cast disagrees with that, let me know.
I don't agree. I've actually been contacted by 3 or 4 families already. So I've kind of had experience with this show, families who have asked if this was appropriate for their kiddos to come, kiddos who know me. And I have very kindly suggested perhaps not. I don't think that the subject will resonate and hold their attention because it is a story of adult relationships. Now, there's no inappropriateness happening whatsoever.
Okay.
And not unlike Angie, my son was sitting in the audience for Rent when he was 4 back then. So I've always taken my children to everything. But I don't know that this is a show that will really hold their attention and certainly not, you know, bring them the sparkle and, you know, and storyline that they might enjoy. So I've just advised some friends to perhaps make this into an adult date night. And this would be a great opportunity for adults to enjoy an evening or afternoon at the theater and perhaps not have the children attend this time if they were younger than those teenage years.
Very good. I think that's an excellent response, Marcia. Thank you. Okay, so how would someone go about purchasing tickets for the show?
I believe they're available on the website. Iowa City Community Theater, theaterwithanre.com. They can also, I believe, call, the number escapes me right now, but they can call the box office.
The box office number for Iowa City Community Theater is 319-338-0443.
The ticket link jumps off of the Facebook post about the show as well. So if you go to the, find it on ICCT's Facebook page, you can jump over to the ticket purchase page from there as well.
Very good. Very good. Many people need to coordinate their schedules, babysitters, dinner, do we eat before or after, getting to and from. To help them in this regard, about how long does this show run?
Today or when we do it? we're still rehearsing it.
Yeah. I know.
Yeah, at this point, I'm looking for 2 hours and 30 minutes. Yeah, 2 hours and 30 minutes, including intermission.
Including intermission. Okay, very good. All right. Again, Follies, produced by Iowa City Community Theater, is being performed, oh, my happy heart, live and in person on Fridays and Saturdays, April 28th and 29th, and May 5th and May 6th at 7:30 p.m., and Sundays, April 30th and May 7th at 2 p.m. Well, it's time to close the curtain on this interview. Thank you all for being here today. It's been such a lot of fun and very informative, and I've really enjoyed our time together. I hope we can do another interview with y'all again soon. Good. Thank you.
The Green Room IC is an original production of KICI Radio in Iowa City. The host for this episode is Beverly Mead, with production by Craig Jarvie. Visit KICI's SoundCloud page to hear this and other Green Room IC interviews.